My name is Jeff Martin. I'm the lead singer, guitarist, producer of the band The Tea Party. Started playing guitar when I was 7. And my father, a bass player and big blues, you know, aficionado, you know, a bit of a purist. So I got a very early education in the blues when I started playing guitar. And then my tastes, you know, like as a kid, I also, like, I loved the Beatles, you know, but not the scary Beatles with the beards and the long hair and all that, right? I got into them later. You know, one thing led to another, and then I think when I was 11 years old, one of my older cousins bought me Sgt. Pepper's because I was such a Beatles nut, right? And that was the first time that I heard like Indian music, you know, like George Harrison playing the sitar and that song Within You, Without You. And it was a weird experience for me because even at 11 years old, and you know, I don't know if you believe in past lives or things like that, but there was something about it, like when I heard that music, it's kind of like I remembered like everything. And it started a passion for me of, you know, reacquainting myself, I guess, you know, with music from India, music from Morocco, music from Turkey and all that. And when the Tea Party was formed back in 1990, and I was writing songs, I wanted to fuse like the elements of like hard rock and world music, you know, together. You know, bands have done it in the past. I mean, like, you know, Zeppelin was a big influence for me as well. And, you know, songs like Kashmir and all that, they took it to that place. But I think what the Tea Party did, especially with our second record, The Edges of Twilight, we took it a lot further. And now it's sort of become our, you know, it's our stamp, you know, and to the point when, like, when other bands try to do that now, they get compared to the Tea Party. So that's cool. But my first acoustic guitar, I got it at 7, and then my father bought me my first electric guitar when I was around 9, and it was a Les Paul copy. And he told me that if I, you know, graduated out of primary school, so grade 8s with honors, you know, he'd get me the real deal. So, and I did, and we drove from Windsor to Toronto to Long McQuaid's music store, and I bought my first real Gibson Les Paul. Well, he did, so. And now I've got like 40 of them, so. I mean, we couldn't be together for like the last 3.5 years, you know, so. And what I'm interested in doing with the band, again, is I would love to take the three of us, like, to Morocco and, you know, spend, like, a couple months there. Just soak it all in, you know, rent, like, one of those beautiful hodges and, you know, just make some music over there, you know, because the last couple EPs, you know, have been more or less, like, sort of, like, straight-up rock and roll, you know, and that's cool. And, you know, I've enjoyed making those, but I think it's time for the Tea Party to, you know, pardon the pun, but, like, you know, piss on its own territory again, you know? So, perhaps that's something down the line. Like, I'm very proud of, like, you know, I think, you know, like, the riff for Black River is, like, it's, you know, it's a classic, you know? And it's weird for me to say that, but... You know, like the guitar work, and it's really it's a testament to Jeff and Stuart because, you know, they pushed me to like really, you know, go back into rock guitar because I tend to, as a producer, I want to make these massive, you know, soundscapes and, you know, all these exotic instruments and things like that. But we kind of, we distilled it, you know, and we went to that more classic sort of rock and roll thing. And, you know, that's done and we did it well and now it's time to move on to something else. You know, like opening up for Jimmy Page and Robert Plant, the Montreal Forum, that was a highlight. Doing that SARS festival with the Stones and AC/DC, like, you know, what was it like? 600,000 people, you know. It was just like playing in front of a city, you know, and it just went on and on and on forever. So that was pretty special to be a part of that. Well, the Tea Party, you know, we took a break from each other for 7 years, and it was a wonderful experience when we got back together, and especially our fan base in Australia is it's crazy. And when we did our reunion show in Sydney at the Horton Pavilion, that was pretty emotional, you know. So there's many more, but I'll just leave it with those three right now. So. It's got to come from a point of truth, right? And I'm pretty blessed. Like, I've lived a very, very big life, and you know, been around the world many times. And I'm also, I'd say I'm a very spiritual person. I'm a self-taught student of esoteric occult philosophies, and you know, that comes into play with some of the lyrics that I write. And it's just about I kind of have a little bit of synesthesia, and I see music in colors. So when I write words, you know, like, I'm kind of writing them towards like a certain color on the spectrum, and I've got so many so many experiences in my life that I can draw upon, you know. So very fortunate in that way, you know, not making anything up. Well, it was something to listen to that again, because my voice was very, very different back then, and also our wings were very wet with our influences, you know. So there was there's a lot of like Jimi Hendrix influence and Zeppelin, but it was interesting because you can hear you can hear what would come from listening to those songs, that collection of songs on the record. Like, even though it was our first version of Save Me was on that record, and then, you know, with Splendor Solus, our first release with EMI, we redid it again, and then it became, you know, this massive song. So it was interesting to see the origins, you know, and the seeds being planted. You know, I think that's the way I look at that record. I'm proud of every single one of them on Sunshower, and but I think just as far as guitar is concerned, the song Our Love, as a guitar composition, I'm very proud of that one, because there's so many layers that happen in that song gradually, you know, just with different guitar parts. So it's like it's a bit of like a guitar orchestra that happens, and you know, at the end it's just massive, you know. And so I'm very proud of that one. Windsor, you know, so the most southern city in Canada, it's right on the border of Detroit. And so, Jeff and I and Stuart all come from Windsor, and Burroughs and I have been, we've known each other since I was 5 and he was 6, you know, and met Stuart the first year of high school, so around 12, 13 years old. And back then, we would spend, especially on weekends, a lot of time in Detroit, because for some strange reason, you could get over the Ambassador Bridge so easy back then. And you could drink underage, you know, in these seedy, seedy Detroit bars, right? And it was amazing, because there was so much music going on in Detroit, like obviously the blues, you know, incredible blues bars back at that time. And also there was, still the Detroit, like, punk, I wouldn't call it punk, but like, you know, it's like the hangover, like, you know, from the MC5 or the Stooges and, you know, that sort of thing, or New York Dolls. Like, there was that kind of scene happening as well. And obviously techno, you know, like house music was born in Detroit, you know. So there was, the original raves and all that. So, like, yeah, Detroit City back then, it was a fucking blast, man, you know. Now they've cleaned it up and it's just quite boring. You know, you look at what's how Berlin, you know, affected Bowie, you know, like back in the 70s, and you know, like the Stones going to Marrakesh, you know, and so it's moments like that in a band's history that, you know, I believe should happen. You know, it's you take like a, you know, a working sabbatical and you reacquaint yourself with what's important, you know. And I think you know, to live it, like to, like for instance, the plan of, you know, going to Morocco and the band, like living there for a couple months, you know, it's much different than just like going there and shooting a video. You know, like you got to soak everything in. You know, you got to meet the people, you got to taste the food, you got to drink the wine. You know, you got to live the life. You know, and that's when I believe like the authenticity would shine through in the music. So as I mentioned that the Tea Party opened up for Jimmy Page and Robert Plant, and this is when they were doing that tour that had like the Egyptian orchestra and all that. It was like the big wah, right? And so the Tea Party, we open up for them at the Montreal Forum, and it was the last show of their tour. Now, they had asked for us to be the support act for like more than half of their tour, because, you know, the Tea Party at that time, we had Edges of Twilight out, and all around the world, we were getting compared, you know, to like, you know, this is like a young Led Zeppelin, but exotic, you know, and all that. And so, of course, Page and Plant are quite curious, right? But because of commitments that we had with the record company and touring already, the only show we could do was the last one. And it was fitting because, like, at that time, I was actually, Montreal was my home. So, so we do the set, and we get a standing ovation in the Montreal Forum, right? And apparently, the manager of Page and Plant at the time told us that, like after our show, like that never happened on the tour. Like, you know, people mostly just wanted the support bands to get off, right? So, you know, that was a big compliment. And then, you know, Page's guitar tech tells me that, well, okay, no, I digress. So I'm on stage and we're performing, and I remember it exactly. We were performing The Bazaar, and it's the second song in the set, and like the band's in full flight. And I look over at Stuart, and on Stuart's side of the stage, like in the wings, is Robert Plant, you know, sipping a cup of tea, watching everything, right? And I'm like, okay, no, fuck, I can handle this. This is all right. I got this. You know, just concentrate, concentrate. And then I look over at my guitar tech, and there's Jimmy Page in that wing, dancing around like a fucking kid, you know? And I'm like, okay, man, I'm gonna fucking lose it now, right? So, so after the show, after our show, Jimmy's guitar tech tells me that Jimmy wants me to stand, you know, in his guitar pit during his show. Right? So I'm getting to watch, you know, like my hero of all heroes, right? Yeah, this is like God playing guitar. And so after their show was done, we're in our dressing room, and we're all just trying to, like, you know, like, did all that just happen, you know? And I swear to God, like, there's this knock on the door of the dressing room, and the biggest black man that I have ever seen, right, comes up and he's like, Mr. Martin, right? Mr. Page wants to see you, right? And I'm thinking, oh man, okay. Because, like, in our set, we did Save Me, and I did the violin bow, you know, like Page used to do with Days of Confused, but he didn't do that in his sets, right? But I did it in ours. And I'm thinking, oh, is he gonna reprimand me for doing that, you know? So anyways, so this biggest black man I've ever seen takes me to Page's dressing room. Page comes bounding out, right? And he's like, oh, you know, Jeff, that was fantastic, you know? Like, you know, you guys, you know, you reminded me of a young Zeppelin, and by the way, you know when you played the violin bow on Save Me, right? And I'm like, okay, fuck, here it comes. He's like, how did you get the high strings to work? Because I could never get those, right? And I was like, okay, you know, I can go to bed now. That's all good.